Okay, hello everybody. I think we are ready to start the next webinar. My name is Joel Jones from the PUCP in Peru, and I will be today's host for the Latin American webinar on physics. We're having our 20th webinar this time. And we today we're having a very interesting talk by Leonidas Aliaga, who's going to talk about the calculation of the NuMI flux. Now, before we start, let me remind you, let me change this, that you can ask questions right here, right? So you can go to the Google Q&A, which should be somewhere around like here. Yeah, you can see it right here. Yeah. And you can also send us your questions via Twitter, right? Which should be like around, let's see if I can get this right. Okay, law physics, right? We also have a new web page, which you can see down here, right? Lawphysics.wordpress.com. And there you can get all of the previous webinars and the current info, right? So let's get back to normal. Here we go. Okay, so I think it is time to start. Let me present Leo. He is a former master's student here in the PUCP University, and he ended up doing the PhD at the College of William and Mary in Virginia. He is actually 1 month away from presenting his PhD thesis, and after this presentation, he shall move on to a postdoc position in Fermilab. Right, and the title of his talk is Calculating the NuMI Flux. So I will leave you with Leo for now. All right, so let me see if I do this properly. Okay, Leo, they are all yours. Let me unmute you. Give me a second. Okay, you're unmuted, Leo. You're ready to start.
Great. Can you hear me and can you see my presentation?
Yes, everything's awesome. Perfect.
Well, I want to start now. Thank you all and thanks everybody at webinar. Thank you for having me and inviting me. I think it's great, this effort. Well, my talk today is about calculating the NuMI flux. It's a big part of my thesis that's going to happen in 2 weeks. This talk is supposed to be long, explain many details, etc. This is the same talk that I gave to Fermilab, this one is Fermilab. 3 months ago, I removed many things to the backup slides. And if you are interested to me to show something that I mentioned, etc., we can go to the backup slide. There is time. Right? Well, first we should ask why is predicting the neutrino flux important, right? In the neutrino oscillation strategy, I don't want to go through every detail about the neutrino oscillation strategy. Just to emphasize that basically we had two separated detectors sharing the same neutrino beam. The detector can be constructed in the kind of similar each other or not similar. This can be in the same axis of the neutrino beam or can be off axis, etc. But at the end, the idea is that every detector, one of them very close to the production product of neutrino that we used to call in our jargon near detector, and the other one sometimes. Few kilometers and sometimes hundreds of kilometers away from the production point of the neutrino beam that we used to call far detector. At the end, that we see in every detector basically events. We count neutrinos, reconstruct, and we do our best. The idea is that relating the events that we see there and other parameters involved, like the acceptance and how well we know the flux that is in each detector and the cross section, etc. We can get our oscillation probability in the formula that you see there. Well, it's just basically a rough approximation. That assumes that, for instance, our detectors are the same, or we can cancel the cross section, etc. But there are problems here. There are challenges here. First one, the flux just partially cancels. I'm going to mention that in the next slide. And the detector is slightly different, even slightly different. The cross section don't necessarily cancel. If you go, slide number 4, I stole this plot from Minos. for instance, for minos, the flux, when they just need to apply the ratio of the flux that they see at the far detector divided over the ratio that they see on the near detector. They can use a simulation for that. The ratio from their simulation, you use Luca, you can see there in the empty boxes with the best value as a dot there. But when they make an effort to tune the Monte Carlo that they use, in order to, with some technique that they have, when they use different configurations of NuMI, etc., this is another topic that I can go in details if you want. But the idea is that they basically get different ratio. That means that it really matters if we understand how the flux is produced in terms of the hadrons that are in the hadronic cascade that lead to neutrino that pass through minos in this case. I mean, that matters. As you can see there, I mean, it's not trivial. The first one, to start with, the uncertainty is reduced for a lot, but also the central value of the ratio change, and that will change our conclusion respect to what they are trying to deliver in terms of the simulation parameters, etc. Slide number five. The other side is, for instance, the importance of the flux to the neutrino cross sections, particularly in the region between 100 MeV and 20 GeV, is an important region now, because many experiments are running at that energy range. MINERvA, for instance, my experiment is running at with the peak at 3 GeV and 6 GeV now. I mean, NuMI is running with the current configuration. NOVA, that is an off-axis experiment, run at 2 GeV, has the peak at 2 GeV, for instance, their neutrino flux. Right? That's a very important regime, but exactly that regime is, how should I say, this is totally a mess in terms of how we know the cross-section. You can see there, I took this plots for neutrino and antineutrino on the left and right side. It's the total cross-section, but also divided in terms of different channels. It's exactly the region that this few GeV that's going from the quasi-elastic that we know relatively well to the deep inelastic extreme with a big contribution from some resonant productions. And you can see that even there are some data that disagree each other. Right? And this is important because the cross-section basically help us to understand what is the distribution, understand what is happening when inside of the nucleus, for instance, and when the final particle is ejected from the nucleus. Right? And that's important. For instance, there is a common experiment called DOOM, that's also the oscillation experience, a big project is that will consist of liquid argon. Right? It's a complicated nucleus, and we need to understand now for that future experiment. Right? We always wonder if those disagreements that they have in this cross-section measurement come from different understanding of what they are measure, of some experiment perhaps is not accurate, or perhaps the way that they understand the flux. And the reason is the following. Slide number six, for instance, this is an experiment I am working on. Right? So a few words, even when this work is not related only to MINERvA. But MINERvA particularly is a cross-section experiment, neutrino cross-section experiment, cover exactly that region. We have high statistics of neutrino and antineutrino flux. We measure inclusive channel, but also every exclusive channel that you see in the previous page. We place different nuclear targets in the upstream part of our detector. That means that we are having a dependence of our cross-section measurements. But roughly speaking, the formula that we use at the end, right, simplifying a lot this, is that it's in the box. So the cross-section is basically the number of events that we see and reconstruct and unfold in our detector, divided over the flux, the number of neutrinos that pass through our detector, and multiply by the number of targets, etc. That means that every uncertainty that goes into the flux goes directly to the cross-section uncertainty. For instance, one recent, well, not recent, 2 years old MINERvA paper, there was a particular channel coherent charged pion production. You can see there that you are interested to read the citation. has this problem, for instance, about this uncertainty that comes from the flux. For instance, the right in the left side, you can see the absolute cross section that we measure in terms of the neutrino energy. Our results are interesting, but if you see in the right side, this is the uncertainty, the systematic uncertainty in cross section units. There are many uncertainties there, but I want to call your attention about the flux uncertainty. The flux uncertainty is very big. It's practically it's an uncertainty dominated by flux. If we can reduce that, or we can understand, or we can do something about that, that's going to impact directly to the data that we release, right? That's why this is so important for MINERvA, the flux. But not just for MINERvA, I just mentioned that oscillation experiments also need to understand the flux because the ratio far over near detector can change. Well, in general, there are many experiments that share the NuMI beamline. There are experiments on axis like MINO, MINERvA, there are all experiments that run before Argonaut, PNAT, etc. There are off-axis experiments like NOVA, and even booster experiments. I mean, we have another beamline that comes from the booster in at Fermilab at 8 GeV, and NuMI comes from 120, that receive a small amount, but can be significant for many reasons, kind of off-axis NuMI beam. The idea is that in some moment we thought that if we can handle this problem and get a flux determination, that can be shared with other experiments as well. But the flux is important. Okay, but why is it so hard to estimate the flux? A few slides about that. Well, the first slide is about how to make a conventional neutrino beam. This is a simplified sketch that I draw there. Well, the idea is that you use a short-lived particle like meson and scions to make neutrinos. We need basically some components for that. For a very intense proton beam colliding with a long target, used to be a long target. In NuMI, we use 120 GeV proton that we extract from the main injector, and we collide in a graphite target that is about 2 interaction length long. We expect that after these collisions that come from the primary, but secondary is also interacting. I mean, proton producing the primary from the primary interaction, but also pions, kaons reinteracting, etc. Some of the particles, especially pions and kaons, are going to leave the target. We place a focusing system. Well, in the sketches, just one magnetic horn, but we use two, for instance. Some other experiments, like medium, for instance, use one, T2K use 3 magnetic horns. The idea is that we want to enhance the mesons that we want to collect and redirect, canceling basically the transverse momentum to make the decay favoring the direction of the beamline, right, and have more neutrinos and more efficiently. And we used to play an extended decay region. We call decay pipe, in our terms, is used to fill by, well, it's used to be vacuum in NuMI. Currently is filled by helium, and we place some absorbers. That's the idea, to make a conventional neutrino beam that works in NuMI and the booster experiments and T2K, etc. Well, particularly NuMI has been running since 2005. Well, has been constructed before. From 2005 to 2012, ran in this low energy mode that produced the flux spectrum for mu neutrino that you can see in the blue line in the plot there at the left side. Currently, it's running in this medium energy that we have a more intense neutrino beam peak at around 6 GeV. Right? That's what we have in NuMI. In this talk, I'm going to be focused on the mu neutrino in low energy, just for matter of a better explanation. Some details about how is our NuMI target. We have, as I mentioned before, it's a graphite. It's made of graphite. It's a rectangular graphite rod. It's segmented in fins. We have around 2 interaction length long, less than 1 meter in the least low energy era that we run in NuMI. In minomer is a little bit longer. But the problem here comes from the following. We have, basically after the first interaction, a hadronic cascade in the target. The target is a it's a busy place after the protons are collided in hit the target. Pions, kaons, and other secondary protons and any other particles are created in cascade in the hadronic interactions. Right, and the problem is the following. For the energy range, 120 GeV, basically these interactions are not perturbed by the QCD. And then this, we cannot, and also there are many degrees of freedom related to this, the NuMI geometry, etc. And then with the simulation, you need to use a model. Right? But we need to be sure that the model reflects what happened in nature, right? You can see, for instance, when I show the Faro-Bernier ratio from Minos, right? That when they constrain the model in order to match what they believe that is the real hadron that is produced out of the target, the Faro-Bernier ratio changed. That means that the model can be wrong for a lot of percentages. I'm going to see next slide number 15. For instance, when we plot the low energy flux in terms of three different hadronic models, red and blue comes from Jan 4, black is Fluca. The difference in the peak can be plus minus, the spread can be even 20%, right? It's a lot. And that's something that we need to address. What happened in terms of the hadron production? That is basically the main focus of this, of the work that I was doing here. The main contribution to the neutrino flux that we have comes from pions, at least for low energy. And those pions are created in primary, secondary, and tertiary interactions, but basically many of them are created from the primary proton interacting in carbon. And that's those, many of them escape the target. Some of them not. I mean, the image is the complete image is more complicated. But the idea is that after they leave the target, they are focused, as I mentioned before. The kinematic region of those pions that are focused and create neutrinos that pass through MINERvA, Minos, and all of these experiments is the plot that is showing in this slide number 16. As you can see, the region that we're interested in terms of the focusing peak particularly is few Feynman X value, no more than 0.1. Feynman X is defined as the longitudinal moment, the fraction of longitudinal momentum seen in the center of mass. The idea is that using that, we are going to have some scaling behavior of the invariant cross section. I'm going to mention that in some slides ahead. But that's the region that we're interested, basically few PT, but no more than 0.6 GeV over C, and no more than 0.1 Feynman X. And that create neutrinos. In slide number 17, you can see, for instance, I'm going to skip the right side, but the left side, so for instance, the neutrino components in terms of their parent identity. Most of the neutrinos, as I mentioned before, come from pion plus. I mean, basically the interaction that we see in the kinematic region that we see in the previous slide, but other regions and other interactions, et cetera, that can move to the back slides. It is interesting that after 20, 25 GeV, kaon parent become dominant. I mean, the mu neutrinos come basically from kaons. In general, in MINERvA, in other experiments, we are interested to constrain not just the pions in the peak, I mean, we are interested to constrain the whole region, right? And the whole region goes from 0 to 120. The other component, important component in NuMI is the focusing. The focusing, as I mentioned before, is composed by two magnetic horns. This is a place here, there, a transverse view. The way that we create this magnetic field that basically focus the pions with the particular charge that we want and defocus the other charge, the opposite charge pion, or meson, etc., is created in this way. Basically, these are, we pulse 200 kiloamps current through the two aluminum horns in the direction that you see there, in order to create a toroidal magnetic field. Conductors, when they make made of aluminum, is a very is not so much. I mean, it's just few millimeter thick. But the idea is that every particle that leaves the target is going to feel that magnetic field and change. After that, they come to the decay pipe. In terms of the uncertainties about all of this process related to the focusing, we make many studies about that. It's the plot is showing number in the slide number 19 is relatively small because it's small around the focusing peak, that is about 3 GeV, as I mentioned before, is around 2% of uncertainty. The most of the uncertainties come from in that falling edge of the focusing peak. I want to mention something because this is important. We don't mention this enough. This is by construction. I mean, when NuMI was constructed, the idea was that have a very small uncertainty around the focusing peak for in that time for this oscillation studies, right? Neutrino oscillation studies. It is a big effort for the neutrino beam group that study from the late 90s how to do that in order to make an efficient beam with small uncertainty around the focusing peak. Right. What is the challenge here? I mean, I mentioned that determining the flux is important. What is the challenge? There are two challenges, the source of two leading causes to a bad bad flux prediction. One of them, as I mentioned before, comes from the focusing system. We study what is the uncertainty associated, but we always try to update and see if the way that we are simulating and we are understanding the focusing is better. It's basically a geometrical problem in general. We see that for the way that the intense interaction that is inside of the target, the size of the magnetic field, the position of the target respect to the horns, and the relative position between the two horns that we have, any small mismodeling in the geometry of NuMI can lead a few percentage discrepancy in the flux respect to what is happening. Right? That's important. Perhaps in the oscillation experiments, mismodeling could cancel. But for us, that we want to measure cross sections, we don't have two detectors. We just have one detector, and those uncertainty we have 5%, 4% that come from a small millimeter misalignment or something that go directly into our uncertainty that we have, or basically in our the central value of the cross section that we want to deliver. Right? Some of the comment examples I have this in backup slides. I mean, how sensitive this to have a precise geometry, especially around the relation between target horn and between horn, right? But the other big component that's going to talk about the rest of this talk is about the hadronic interaction. I mentioned that we need a model, and the model can disagree up to 20% in the focusing peak and even more, right? We need external data to constrain the production. That's basically that we are new in order to know our flux. We need basically two quantities. We need to correct the interaction probability of the hadrons in any material, and given the interaction happened, correct the probability that a hadron is produced in the right kinematic beam. Right? For the first one, we need basically the cross section. Right? For the second one, we did the total cross section. For the second one, we need the differential cross section. What sort of data is available in order to correct the hadron production? That is our biggest concern now. We make a survey. And we find basically two kinds of experiments that can help us. There are thin target experiments that release basically cross sections, differential cross sections, yields, etc. And also thick target experiments that basically collide protons on a long target, and they use to measure yields. This is the data relevant that we found in order to correct our hadron production in our beamline. from thin target experiment, there are many experiments. For instance, all experiments, Belletini, Denisov, some of them are Fermilab, CERN, and Russia, etc. We take advantage of all of this data from the inelastic cross-section. But there are some recent data that help us a lot now. One of them is data released from NE49. NE49, NX61, and all of these CERN experiments are hadron production experiments trying to test quark gluon plasma and how is the hadronization, etc. But when they measure some data like proton and carbon, that's exactly what we have, right? And we can use the data, 150 AGB, that is the incident proton energy that they use, is very close to what we have in NuMI, is 120, right? And we have other sets of data that we use, and all experiments from Fermilab, Corbarton, etc. But the idea is that we want to incorporate all of this, the data that we know, in order to correct the hadron production. Recently, we have some interesting data that come from MIP experiments, main injector particle production at Fermilab, that measure exactly, I mean, they basically took a spare target, one of the targets that was working for NuMI, and they measured how is the hadron production for this target. That's very important data that we have also available. Here it is. Well, in terms of how bad is our is the simulation, I mean, not just simulation, is the prediction from the model respect to real data. I have three slides about that. For instance, in terms of the inelastic cross-section, there are some details about inelastic absorption here. I'm not going to go there. But the idea is that you can see that in terms of the model can disagree completely. For instance, all of this data that we placed there for inelastic cross-section of proton and also some data from neutron interacting in carbon, right, basically predict that we have a flat distribution, flat in terms of energy distribution of inelastic cross-section. The model does not say that. we correct that. That's my point. In terms of the production of pions, for instance, NE49 measured pion production from proton carbon at 158 GeV, as I mentioned before. This is a busy slide. We are going to represent the following. Let's see. The x-axis is the Feynman x variable. As you remember, the region that we're interested in is between 0 and 0.1 Feynman x. The vertical axis is the transverse momentum. That is a region of interest from 0 to 0.6, right, for the peak, but the whole region contributes to the flux, right? And we place there some lines in order to show this quantum show. Basically, the inner one is the place that we have more pions. I mean, we were trying to place in the same plot something that represent that you saw before. I mean, when is the region that we're interested? Right? The peak of the region is exactly at 0.2 transverse momentum and 0.5. Right? And I forgot what I think contains the first one. We're incrementing like the first curve is like 20%, 30, 50, etc. But sorry, the idea is that you can relate that with the previous slide. I forget the numbers here. The same in the top of the plot, I place also some approximate value because this pion, for instance, in the case of pion decay, is just a two body decay, and we can have an approximate energy of the neutrino. Related to the pion parent, right? And then you can see that, for instance, how every region contributes to different neutrino energies. But the idea is that NE49, for instance, give us a good data coverage. It's great. We are using that data to correct our flux. The other data that come up recently, in 2014, is NIP, as I mentioned before. They measure exactly the NuMI target, and the coverage around the focusing peak, right? I pointed out this in the plot, as you can see there, is good, right? These are measuring basically the x-axis is the longitudinal momentum, and the y-axis is the ratio. every line there is the ratio between the data that they measure over our Monte Carlo, or how our model say that is the production in the target, and they add one in order to separate the lines, right? But you can see there that the coverage is good. What is our strategy to calculate the flux? I'm going to simplify this, basically saying that the idea is to implement all of this hadron data. We have even more, because we have data that come from team target, right? Many of them, I just described N49, but we have more than N49. And we have a deep target that already contains, like, the pion that lives, or the particle that is measured that leaving the target, also is a convolution of every interaction that happened in the target. I mean, we have kind of more information that that we need. But the idea that our correction works is basically we correct the neutrino yield that we see in MINERvA or any other experiment at NuMI. I mean, we are not interested. My point here is that we are not interested to correct the model itself. We are interested to correct the right neutrino yield that we want to see in any point in the NuMI in MINERvA, for instance. Right? And then we basically see what is the history of a neutrino in terms of the interaction that happened in the hadronic cascade to produce a neutrino and correct that interaction. That's our procedure. We apply two corrections. The first correction is correcting basically the right beam attenuation. I mean, basically the right probability that the particle pass through a material without interacting, or pass through a material without interacting and interacting in a particular point. We correct that, and that depends on the total cross section. We apply that, and we have data for that, as just mentioned a few slides before. The other correction that we apply that is also important is that for thin target data, for instance, we correct the production in terms of they release their data in terms of invariant double differential cross sections. They release a 158 GeV, supposed to, according to Feynman, his paper, he said that using Feynman X, you should scale between different energies, right? And the invariant cross section should be independent of the energy, like Jorgen X. But he never explained why, but there is some violation related to that. And we account to that doing that some fluke accounting for that violation of the Feynman scaling. And we check that because we have more data. We have an existing one that measures exactly the same pion production from proton carbon and 13G, and then basically correct. We see that the scaling is working, right? Because they have a 158 GeV incident proton, 31 GeV, and we are basically in the middle, right? From tick target data, we correct the yield. But when we don't have data, we have to do something, right? The idea is that we were conducting a long study in my experiment, how we can scale this proton-carbon interaction, for instance, from N49, to other materials, looking basically how this cross-section, variant cross-section, scale when we change material. It's not that easy as just counting the number of nucleons that is in the nuclei. And we basically find an uncertainty associated when we extend the coverage to other materials. And we use all the theoretical guidance. We use everything, because at the end we want to reduce the situation in which we don't have any data or any clue to apply. In the past, we use something that is very risky, but this we only see that we have. It's just basically take all of the models that we have, predict the flux in different parts of the of NuMI, and find the spread. But we don't know exactly if the nature is inside of this spread between models. And also, we don't know what is, it's hard to find the internal correlation between these models that we can be overestimated or underestimated. The second option that we're following, and we're hearing a lot these years, is like basically have our best guess, but anchor to data if at all possible. That means that looking the agreement with all the data sets, we find, for instance, that our model, the model we use, for instance, the discrepancy in all of these data sets, respect to the other data set, when we have data, sorry, for instance, pions, et cetera, the discrepancy is no more than 40%. And we do that now. Results. Oh, it's about the time. Oh, yeah. I have to start finishing. Well, as I mentioned before, we have, in our survey, we had thin target and thin target data, and this gives us the opportunity to have like two flux predictions. For instance, what happens if we correct the Monte Carlo, the model, using just thin target data? Or we can correct the model using thick target data, for instance, just taking the NIP data, right, and use thin target in all other places that is not covered by NIP. That's what we're doing now. And that's our work that has the last years, try to understand, because if we have two flux predictions, canceling all correlation between them, they should agree, right? They don't agree. And that was a big problem. I mentioned this in the backup slide, but basically we found that thin target data, when we use a different procedure, agrees basically with the other procedure that I was going to mention in a couple of slides, and not thin target data. That's a very interesting topic, because we learn a lot about what, in terms of hadron production, right? I moved this to the backup slide if you are interested. In terms of interaction covered, for instance, for thin target data, that's happened in the slide number 36. I plot there the neutrino energy in the x-axis, and the y-axis I am plotting here the average number of hadronic interactions per mu neutrino that pass through MINERvA. The total is shown in the black line right there, is about 2.2 for very low neutrino energy, but it's around 1.4, almost flat after that. Any other line represent a different kind of data or procedure that we don't follow to handle those interactions. For instance, the solid blue line and the dashed blue line represent, for instance, the average number of those interactions handled by pions or kaon production from proton carbon, basically Na49, and other data that we use to extend, right, respectively. Other data set handle other subdominant components, like, for instance, nucleon production from proton carbon that we also have data. I haven't mentioned that, but there are many components there. But there are some places that we don't have data, and we are either extending the data coverage by using theoretical inputs, or we don't have any data at all. And we use, as I mentioned before, like conservative 40% there, right? Is this dash brown line that we call nucleon A, and the legend can be misleading. Is any nucleon interacting, producing any particle in the neutrino history there? I mean, the contributor that is not covered by data, right? Some of them are covered by this extension from proton carbon to other materials, to proton in other materials. But others are not basically covered by any data, and we just have our best guess, right? Conservative, but our best guess, anchoring data, as I mentioned before. That is the place that we need data, for instance, and that can help us reduce. When you see the fractional uncertainty associated to every line, you're going to understand why it's so important to have direct data there, and how this work can help to ask for this kind of measurements in the future hadron production experiments. In terms of the material traverse, right? This is the average material traverse in terms of mole over centimeter square. That is something that we are counting also. Right? The main contribution, as you can see there, comes from this parent to neutrino. From those pions that travel. The idea is for the angle, because the pion producing the targets has the boost of the primary proton beam, and also for the multi, and they leave the target in the very small, and they leave up to 10 centimeters. That's a lot, because the aluminum has, I forgot, but between 40 and 50 centimeter interaction length. That means that the enemy's model of the absorption with elastic cross-section won't matter. That's the results in the run number 38 that we have. We basically, using all of this data, I forgot to mention that also we study how to correlate the data, the systematic, the bin-to-bin systematic error that we have, the statistical errors, etc. We got these results in the run number 38. Basically, this is for low energy. Neutrino spectrum at MINERvA with small error bars. In well-known error bar for us. And LAN number 39 corresponds to the uncertainties associated to this calculation. The total uncertainty is not bad, can be better. It's around the focusing peak, is 7%, between 6 and 8, 7%, which is good for our measurement. That's going to improve a lot. The for instance, the coherent charged pion production, another publication that we had in MINERvA, I have the list in the backup slide, because they were published before this work. We need to update there and want to reduce the uncertainties. That's going to be crucial for our cross-section measurements. You can see there the different contribution, but I want to emphasize here this brown dashed line that represent places when we are applying indirect data, or when there is no data at all. That's the need. For us, in general, for the neutrino community, from hadron production experiments, to measure that kind of data. For instance, proton interacting in aluminum and see how is the production from those interactions, or other interactions that we call quasi-elastic, that have we don't have data, basically. We have the old reference from the 60s, if I remember correctly. The other thing that we are doing is trying to get the flux for other means. There is a low new technique that I'm not going to explain deep. I'm just going to mention one thing, is that we can express the differential cross section in terms of new, this variable that is basically the hadronic recoil energy. Right? The energy can be the energy transfer in the interactions. That kind of differential cross-section can be parameterized. There are some papers there, etc., about this. In terms of ABC, that basically contains the transfer functions, it's an integrated transfer functions, and some new, this variable, the hadronic recoil energy, divided over E, the neutrino energy. If we have this new over E small, that means new small, we can get a constant differential cross-section. And if we have a constant cross-section, and if we measure that in MINERvA, we are going to have, using the formula before, the shape of the flux. If we anchor this to a high energy measure of the cross-section, for instance, NOMAD, that measure a high energy, the cross-section in carbon, for instance, a high energy, we can basically normalize that and have another measure of the flux. This is a kind of second. This is kind of an in situ measurement. I mean, depend of how well MINERvA reconstruct the recoil energy, but the hadronic recoil energy is not using as our a priority measurement because depend of MINERvA, but it can use basically as a test if we are doing something correctly. That's what we have in the next slide, right? It's like basically when I took the ratio between our prediction that I mentioned before, right, using this hadron production correlation with the low new prediction, that's the ratio you can see there in terms of the in the uncertainty, they agree with very well. Right? I have to mention that there's a couple of percentages that the uncertainty is overestimated because we didn't have the technology to cancel the correlation between them. These are my conclusions here. It's crucial for MINERvA and other experiments, as I mentioned before, to have a precise measurement of the flux with small uncertainties. We create, we make a computation of the NuMI flux with reduced uncertainties in terms of what we had before, and improve also our error budget accounting. We count any error, any possible error that we can have now. But the important thing that we made this work is that we made this work thinking that to share this work with other experiments. And we had, I have in the backup slide, calculation for instance, NOVA flux with an error around from 8 to 10 GeV. That's important because the current error from NOVA is 20%, as far as I know. That means that we can provide a well-understood flux for NOVA, for instance, in with small errors. That's the extent of this work. Our procedure also can be extended to other beam lines. In the future, DOOM can take advantage of this work and also can indicate to hadron production experiments what sort of data we need. That's something that we made. And there's a paper in preparation. It was released soon. This soon can be, I don't know, I will not say what means soon here, but it's going to be soon if you are interested to know more details about this work. Well, thank you.
Thank you very much, Leo. Now is the time for the questions. Let me remind everybody that if you're watching from the Q&A, you can ask the questions directly there. And if you're following from YouTube, for instance, you can use this hashtag lawphysics, right? Not at, but hashtag, all right? So I don't know if there's any questions from the audience here.
Yeah, I have a question. Sorry. Do you know why is this different between the cross-section of between neutrino, anti-neutrino, and nucleons? I mean, why one is two or three times higher than the other? You put it in the beginning almost. I guess it's this four or five. Is it in the very beginning of your talk?
I mean, it's already, it's in share screen, sorry.
You can share your screen right now.
You can see that now, right? Is that number five? Oh, sorry.
Now yes.
Yeah, sorry. there are many details there, right? But and there's a big debate now, right? The idea is that it can be many things. One of them is that different definitions that the neutrino community are using to define their channels. They can be also that some experiments don't understand correctly the nuclear effect, for instance. And the other one can be the flux, as I mentioned before. I mean, maybe the flux is some experiment use understand differently the flux or not understand it completely, and at the end they got disagreement, right? Any cross-section depends strongly on the flux. If the flux is 20% off in some region, that the cross-section ought to be 20% off. That's the point. The extension of this work is interesting because we understand exactly our flux. We implement everything. And now, for instance, after my thesis defense, it will be interesting to have like a time to compare, for instance, with other experiments. I mean, what has NOVA, what NOVA has, MINOS, etc., and see what is, right, the any source of any discrepancy, and maybe that can help to solve. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
So I don't know. Yeah, I don't know if there's any other question. I have a couple of questions. Oh, no, hang a second. Here's one on the Q&A. So the question is, what does the new flux calculation mean for cross-section estimates, and how does this compare with mini-boom results?
That's very interesting, because I have a plot here. I'm not expert on this plot that I'm going to show, but this is a person working in MINERvA, because that's slide number 60. In the right side, we have the, when the right side, I think we have the some cross-section results that we published in MINERvA, right? And you can see in the left side with the, these new results, the output can change.
Sorry, Leo, we can't hear you properly. Could you please repeat your answer?
The answer is the following. For instance, in line number 60 that you can see there, we have, I think I have correctly, I'm not sure, but the idea is that this is a measurement of chance current quasi-elastic scattering in MINERvA that was published in 2013 in the right side, right? There are some work in progress that trying to see how our previous result has to be updated in order to incorporate the new you can see there the difference can be big, because I'm not familiarized with every of these models that we are listing there, but previously we favored some model, but updating this with a more knowledge we can favor a different model, right? That's the impact of this work, and not only is updating their our previous results, but also that's very interesting. There's something that I haven't done that yet, but I want to do, because minimum has an interesting flux result that they published. They mentioned that in their paper that basically take fluca. Take the MINOS result from this procedure that I mentioned, and also incorporate some hadron production, I think NA49. That would be awesome to I don't know how it's going to impact minimum, honestly. That similar work as I showing here in the slide number 60 can be done in order to see how the results are going to change, right? It's not just taking a ratio between the old and new flux and basically scale. It's also a new flux abstraction can change. I mean, so the amount of background can change. Study Monte Carlo simulation, Monte Carlo, etc. That means that if you have new flux, we need to re-understand how the background work. I mean, it's not that easy to just take the ratio and update our result. That's something I'll do in MINERvA, but that's very interesting. That I have no idea, but it would be interesting to see how it can affect that to minimum, for instance, some discrepancy that they have. Yeah, looking forward for that.
Okay, thank you very much, Leo. I don't know if there's any other question. So I have one naive question.
That's some good dangerous question.
No, it's just I was wondering about LHCF, right? I mean, would that data be also important for you at some point?
I'm not familiarized with LHCF. What energy are going to they're going to run?
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's a what's it called? Forward detector at LHC. It's on Atlas, I think, or on CMS. I'm not really sure. But in principle, the what they're trying to do is to improve the cross sections. Okay. Their aim is to focus it on cosmic rays, uh-huh. Right? But I was wondering if that could also be of any use to you. I mean, I guess that in your case, you're more concerned about interactions with protons and the nucleons, right? Well, the other one would be proton-proton, I guess. But I was just wondering if that could be of some use.
Yeah, it's always useful. But I wonder if, I mean, we're interested of in this particular case of any hadronic interaction up to 120 GeV, because that's the energy of NuMI. I'm not familiar with the method that, the experiment that you mentioned, but I suppose they're going to be higher energy.
Yeah, I guess so.
But honestly, you're right. We are interested, for instance, in proton interaction, especially we have enough data for proton carbon, but we're interested, for instance, proton in aluminum or proton in iron, for instance. And also, there is something that a few data, there are some data, but few pion interactions. We have some measurements of HARP experiment for 2 eV pion incident. There are some measurements at N61, I think 400 GeV, and we have nothing in the middle. There is some people that are studying now some N61 data at 30 GeV, but as I mentioned before, we have late data. For it. We need now anything else.
Okay. I'm seeing there's a new question in the Q&A. By Sebastian Sanchez. So this is the following. So GeMI seems to give a worst fit to data with the NuMI flux. Do you know what? Oh, sorry. Yes.
Yeah, the first part I could not listen. There was a.
Oh, sorry. So the question is GeMI, uh-huh. Like GeMI seems to give a worst fit to data with the NuMI flux. So, do you know what could be the reason?
Honestly, you talk about the line number 60, right?
Sorry?
I don't know. You're talking about the line number 60, I suppose. No. Honestly, I don't know. I'm not familiarized with what is internally happening there. I mean, what is modeling there. It looks like GeMI has this model called relativistic Fermi gas, right? But neuro that agree better, especially when we add this transverse enhanced model, TNN, agree better. That's what I can say, but I cannot say anything else because I am not familiarized enough.
Okay, thank you.
With that.
Right. So I don't know if the audience has got any other questions.
I have another question, but it's kind of in the sense, because in your talk you mentioned, for example, Fluca, now GeMI, there is this. Do you know which other software or codes people use to simulate a neutrino or proton? Proton-nucleon interaction to production for neutrinos,
In terms of the simulation of these conventional NuMI beams, the people use Fluca, basically. Fluca had a good agreement with, we know that with many experiments, right? I mean, reflect, it's very close to data. And people use JAM4. We're using JAM4, for instance, for our work. And we use Fluca for other purposes, like scaling, et cetera, et cetera. For neutrino interactions, that is the other part, the people start using GeMI as a standard simulation. It's very... MINERvA used GeMI, for instance. Taking advantage of this, because... somewhat related to your question, Sebastian, I think, asked for GeMI, right? That is interesting to notice that is that 60, the right side, right? It's a curious coincidence, even more than a coincidence, right? But for instance, before, in the right side, for instance, line number 60, you have my slide, right? Because I'm sharing the screen. Before, we have neuro, right? I mean, our prediction agree better with NuRO using an axial mass 0.99. Right? When NuRO improve their simulation, right, their model, including this effect that was not including before, it exactly, I mean, the agreement was not good, right? Because this is the green line, right? But when we update our flux, right, they go in the right direction to agree. That was the interesting thing to mention, right? Yeah, but yes, that's what I wanted to complement the Sebastian's question.
All right, any other question? I have one last question. I was wondering if you could give any details regarding the lack of agreement between the thin and the thick data.
Thank you for that question, because that was a very expensive word. Let's see if I have. For instance, the number 44, this is the same plot that I showed before, I mean, but now in terms of the thick target. The red line, the red solid and dashed line represent what is covered by thick target, in this case, MIP, right? And you can see that the coverage, remember the blue line before, the coverage is better around the focusing peak. We cover a lot with thick target. That means that we expect that the uncertainty is going to reduce for a lot, right? That was great, right? And the blue line, I mean, the thin target data, basically in the 49, reduced because mostly all of the interaction are covered by thick target, right? That's the result for thick target. In the left side, the results in terms of correction in the error band. In the right side, the fractional uncertainties. You see that we reduce a lot, right? The uncertainties are around 5%. That itself tells proof that it is very important for the neutrino community to have thick target data. I mean, that would be great to have more data than that. But when we take the ratio of both, canceling all possible correlation between them, you can have that they disagree. And we study this a lot. It's just this is the ratio, but there is bean-to-bean correlation that is not taken into account in this ratio. But when we study that, we see that it will be hard to reconcile assuming different bean-to-bean correlations to make this ratio between the flux predicted by thick target data plus divided over the flux predicted by thin target data to reconcile, right? They should be around one, in the right, and it's not. And that motivated us to compare with another measure in MINERvA that is not direct measurement of the flux. I mean, that depends of the how well we reconstruct the recoil energies, etc. But at least can give us a clue about if which data set is representing more physics consistency, and which data set need more study. Maybe we need to study more there, and that's what we're doing now. And in line number 47, you have that. When you will divide, for instance, this prediction from using thick target data over the low nu, we have this disagreement, right? And there even the uncertainty kind of 2% overestimated there. It's about 2 sigma in some points, and that's big. That's why we decided to go for the next round of MINERvA papers that are going to happen soon, and for our revisited cross-section data that we already published, use thin target data. But we are currently studying also how we can learn from hadron production when we're trying to reconcile both predictions. But currently, we haven't found a way, and we are going to go using thin target data as a standard flux for the next MINERvA paper round we're going to publish.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I don't know if there's any other last question.
I have two questions, mm-hmm. Leo. Okay. One is just if you can comment more or less the time scale of the experiment to run. I mean, when you MINERvA is going to run and find enough statistic or whatever to the to really have good measurement of this cross-section in the energy of the experiment.
Well, as you know, as I mentioned, MINERvA was running in, NuMI has these two modes, low energy mode, a peak at 3 GeV, that started running in 2005. MINERvA started running in 2009, 2010. I'm missing something here, but around that time. And we already have data published. Trying to find this here. But we already published some data. And now we are doing analysis in, well, revisiting the analysis from low energy and making analysis for the medium energy. But we already, what is this? We already published data cross section in the last year. For instance, this trans current coherent pion production. I'm trying to look for the list of. Here it is. This is the list of papers that we already released. There is one paper that's missing there, some pion production there. But basically, that's the list of papers that we already published. Charge current quasi elastic interactions. For instance, that this data is not being incorporated yet in the plots from the PDG that I mentioned, the PDG page that I mentioned before that shows the all data available for cross-section, right? This, because that plot was 2012. I'm not sure if this is an updated version of that plot, but the idea is that MINERvA data is happened really soon, recently, and then it's currently being incorporated in compared with other data and incorporated also in the generators like Gini and Muro, etc.
Okay, and the last one, that just fast, in the sense of what is the implication that you have for the, for instance, neutrino oscillation, since you are measuring especially muons, and there are some trying to find some analysis with, for instance, with the sterile neutrino, something like that, but in other experiments like higher energies like Ice Cube. I don't know if there are some talk between experiment to figure out what could be happening.
Yeah, you said in terms of the flux?
Yeah, or cross-sections.
Yeah.
I mean, with disappearing or appearance of, since MINERvA has especially very good resolution to measure fluxes of muon neutrinos, for instance. Mm-hmm. So any kind of deviation with respect with the standard expectancy would be noticed, no?
Yeah. Definitely is going to have a big impact, right? Because we are, by measuring the cross section, we are in that part, in the region that many experiments are running the oscillation studies. We are giving results there. I suppose that it's going to help many things understanding the nuclear effects. Improving the generators that they use to simulate the neutrinos, testing models. I have not the big picture of where, I mean, how is our data, MINERvA data is being used now by the neutrino community right now, but definitely is having impact.
Okay. So I do not see any new question. So, okay, let me, all right. Okay, so that's it for today. Thank you very much, Leo, for your fantastic webinar and for answering all of our questions so patiently. I'd like to remind everybody that we're having our next webinar in about 2 weeks. This time it's Jernej Kamenik, who will be giving us an update on the diphoton resonance at 750 GeV. So don't forget to follow our what's it called, our web page, our WordPress web page, and I'll see you. We'll see you soon in our next web page. So thanks for following.